This video is sponsored by MUBI, a curated film streaming and downloading service that brings you the best of independent, classic, and world cinema. Right now, viewers of 100 Years of Cinema can receive a 30-day free trial by visiting mubi.com/100years. The Wizard of Oz is, by some estimates, the most watched film in history, so really it should need no introduction. It's the story of a young farm girl cast adrift in the magical fantasy land of Oz, desperately trying to find her way back home. Along the way, she meets friends, defeats enemies, and learns important lessons. It's a fairy tale for the modern age, perfecting the delicate mix between delight and fear, and over the last 80 years, it's remained one of the most magical films ever made. More than any other aspect, what stands out about The Wizard of Oz is not the amazing special effects, or its use of eye-popping technicolor, or the unforgettable performances from Judy Garland or Margaret Hamilton. It's the music. Somewhere Over the Rainbow and Follow the Yellow Brick Road have become integral parts of the popular culture. But what's particularly interesting is how the music is interwoven into the plot and the diegesis of the world, and what it can tell us about the form and style of the movie musical. Hello and welcome to 100 Years of Cinema. We'll be taking a look at least one film each year from 1915 onwards to track the evolution of film over the last century. It will surprise no one to learn that the musical predates cinema. The intertwining of story and music goes back millennia, but there's a big difference between the film musical and the stage musical. Popular stage musicals, as they existed in the early 20th century, came in a few different forms. Musical comedies and operettas intertwined their music into the plot, but the most popular forms of musical theatre, vaudeville and minstrel shows, were built from a variety of different acts, musicians, artists and comedians, all put on the same bill without a singular narrative thread to pull them together. But what is common to all forms of musical theatre is the separation of the performers and the audience. Though a character may break the fourth wall, the geography of a stage performance is very clearly defined, with the players in their places and the audience fixed into their point of view. The film musical, however, exists in an impossible place, one that's unique to the art of cinema, where the boundaries between the diegetic world of the characters and story intersects with that of the world of the audience, and by subverting traditional rules of film construction, the acts of observation and participation are blurred, and the audience enters a magical land. The film musical didn't always occupy this space. The evolution of the musical in some way mirrors Dorothy's journey into Oz, from the dreary prairies of Kansas to a land of opulence, colour, and magic. The very beginning of the musical can be traced to cinema's first foray into mixing moving pictures with audio in the late 1800s with sound on disc systems like the kinetophone, which combined single viewer peep shows with emerging gramophone technology to bring opera and orchestras to the masses. These early sound on disc systems had major limitations. They were difficult to synchronize, low fidelity and quiet, but the biggest drawback was an inability to move the camera, which made the earliest combinations of film and music little more than flat recordings of stage shows, not yet a unique art form in themselves. This problem followed the musical into the talkies. The first screen musicals either operated like The Jazz Singer, which intertwined music and story, but still had the characters performing on stage to an audience within the film, or films like The Hollywood Review of 1929, which were essentially huge vaudeville-style events with no linking plot, simply treating the cinema audience as a theatre audience. The earliest musicals mainly took place within the setting of Broadway or musical theatre, giving the music a logical context within the plot. It would be a few years before we would see film musicals operate the way that we see them today, with characters suddenly breaking from their world and bursting into song. The subverting of cinematic norms to that degree required a level of audience sophistication that was impossible at the dawning of the early talkies. Cinema-goers had yet to develop a relationship to the medium of talking pictures. In fact, the earliest talkies didn't even mix in non-diegetic sound, such as background music or sound effects, for fear of confusing the audience with sounds emanating from unseen sources. Musicals would remain rigid and stage-bound until the late 1920s. the Broadway Melody became the first film to use a pre-recorded soundtrack, allowing the camera to move around the set, giving the audience multiple angles on the action and choreography. Suddenly, we could go from a full view of the stage to a close-up of a performer's face, allowing the cinema audience perspectives that would be impossible in a theatre. Up until this point, musicals would be stage-bound, but it wouldn't be long before this newfound freedom of the production track allowed the film musical to develop one of its most recognisable tropes, the spontaneous breaking into song and dance by the characters. Ernst Lubitsch's first talking picture, Love Parade from 1929, was also one of the first musicals to take its characters off the stage and into the world.
Snuggle near, baby dear, why so haughty and severe? Let's get together and cuddle up right here.
Integrating the music into the plot and taking the musical one giant step closer to the magic it would see in its golden age. In 1933, three landmark musicals choreographed by Bugsby Berkeley would push the roving camera even further. Berkeley was known for his hugely elaborate and sometimes surreal dance sequences. Instead of choreographing for the perspective of the stage to an audience, he designed his dances for the camera, often starting on a stage but then moving around rooms with close-ups, pans, and aerial shots that revealed geometric shapes that would have been invisible to a theatre audience and could only be captured by the lens of a camera. Throughout the 1930s, the musical would move in and out of popularity. The rise of superstar dance teams like Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers helped push the musicals farther and farther into this magical space. But it was really producer Arthur Freed who would help elevate the musical into its golden age, with his first film, The Wizard of Oz. Freed's approach to the musical was an organic one, having the musical numbers emanate from the plot of the film, balancing the music with the narrative and the themes. This is evident in the structure of The Wizard of Oz. The film is very episodic, with the majority of the story taking place in small vignettes, establishing Dorothy's home life, her arrival in Oz, meeting the major characters, accepting and then finishing a quest, and finally returning home. But each of these episodes are strung together with a musical number that either reveals a character's primary motivation, or advances the plot.
If I only had a brain,
if I only had a heart,
if I only had the nerve.
For the first time in cinema, the musical numbers are completely integrated into the story. They reveal new information about the characters and the world that we don't get any other way. Removing the music would destroy all logic and structure from the narrative. But the music in The Wizard of Oz serves a higher purpose. Even before Dorothy reaches the Land of Oz, she breaks from the diegesis and internal logic of the world in order to communicate her feelings directly to the audience. This music exists between reality and unreality, combining the vocals that exist in the universe of the film, then a music score that can only be heard by the audience. This confusion of the filmic space, the combination of the diegetic and non-diegetic sounds, can only happen in the strange land of the super-diegesis. This is where the magic happens. In order for this to work, the audience must be totally willing to completely suspend their disbelief and accept that this medium exists neither entirely in our world or the fictional world of the film. Once they step foot in this new and strange land, they're beholden to an entirely new set of rules and logic. This has two effects. First, as a preconditioning for the more fantastical elements of The Wizard of Oz. Is the Munchkin Land, a talking scarecrow, or a flying monkey really so far-fetched once we have allowed the characters to reach out and touch the fringes of our world? Once we accept the magic of the musical format, it's not so hard to accept the wondrous things in The Wizard of Oz without question and instead allow ourselves to be completely absorbed into the story. Secondly, it has a wider impact on the genre of musicals as a whole. The realm of the super diegesis frees the characters from the normal rules of film conventions and allows for the magical realism that would become integral to the Hollywood musical. Once the form of the musical abandons structural logic, the content can follow suit, and suddenly entire towns can sing and dance in unison. Characters can freely express their emotions and explain plot points through music, and the music has an impact on the world around them. Even in films that seemingly take place in the real world, characters can suddenly gain superhuman strength and abilities. Conversations can span great distances in time and space that fly in the face of traditional continuity editing. Lovers can suddenly defy the laws of gravity. Freed's abandoning of traditional filmmaking norms developed into one of the most important aspects of the musical, the drawing in of the audience into the diegesis, giving them a sense of almost being a participant in the story. Perhaps the best example of this comes from a later musical produced by Freed, Singing in the Rain. The number You Were Meant for Me takes place on a Hollywood soundstage. The sweeping, unbroken shots mimic the grace of Gene Kelly and Debbie Reynolds, effectively treating the camera as a third dancer in the scene and the audience's point of view as part of the choreography. You can see the roots of this in The Wizard of Oz, with the shot of Dorothy going through the door of her sepia cabin into the technicolor world of Oz. The wonder of the character matching the wonder of the audience as we enter a new land together. The Wizard of Oz was an entirely new kind of musical. Freed cast a spell onto the world of Oz, one that bound the audience to the characters, world, and story, and it's a spell that has remained unbroken for the last 80 years. It changed the feeling and tone of the movie musical, elevating it to an art form that can only exist within the medium of cinema, creating a wonderland as colourful and magic as Oz itself, making the musical a perfect place for a viewer to escape to whenever they feel the need to seek the bluer skies that can only exist over the rainbow. Hey, thanks for watching, my name's Charlie. I wanted to say a special thank you to everyone that supports me on Patreon, particularly my latest supporter, Taline. I also want to thank MUBI for sponsoring this video. MUBI is a curated film streaming service. There are 30 hand-picked films to watch each month, with a new film released every day. It features cult classics and award-winning masterpieces, forgotten gems, and brand new releases from independent filmmakers from every corner of the globe. If you're a film fan, you should definitely check it out and get yourself a 30-day free trial by visiting mubi.com/100years. You'll find a link in the information box below. If you click on the screen, you'll find links to more of my videos. You can click to subscribe and gain access to exclusive bonus videos by supporting me on Patreon. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.
I've never heard of a beautiful witch before.
Only bad witches are ugly.